Many students come to the social sciences really looking forward to engaging with ideas. Then they discover that they need to understand some statistics, and they get nervous and worried. There's really no need for that. Firstly, you need to appreciate that some ideas can only be understood if you understand some statistics. But secondly, you'll discover that if you take the statistics slowly, one step at a time, it's much less difficult than you might imagine. To illustrate this, we're going to look at one particular business and use a formula to arrive at a conclusion which is counterintuitive, something that you really wouldn't have expected. And we'll break the formula down, take it slowly, and I'm sure you'll find that it really won't be as difficult as you thought it might be.
I reckon he's going to win this.
He says he reckons he's going to win this.
You'll see lots of adverts where the business claims that you can get the best value by dealing with them because you can deal directly with them and cut out the middleman.
He said,
on Betfair, you cut out the middleman.
Yeah, and when you come to us direct, we can give you savings.
So really honest, wise to avoid a middleman.
It'll cost ya.
At Safe Auto, you save on state minimum coverage because we cut out the middleman.
When you buy a big brand mattress, you pay for a lot of stuff you don't really need.
And by dealing with the manufacturer, you avoid all the costs of going through the middleman, who is simply a parasite. He does nothing useful. He contributes nothing.
Because all you pay for is a great mattress. No middlemen, no mumbo jumbo.
One example of this you often see is with kitchens. Go direct to the kitchen manufacturer. Don't go to the middleman. What we're going to do is to use a simple formula to show you that this idea is complete nonsense. The middleman is not a parasite on society, but a man or a woman who performs a valuable function in keeping costs down. Before we come to the formula, you need to understand the idea of what we call transactions costs. Any business has some costs which are directly related to the manufacturing process, but there are other costs too. Transactions costs are the costs associated with the exchange process. You have to have somebody advertising, somebody producing price lists, somebody going around negotiating deals and so on. These are the costs not directly associated with the production of the good that we call transactions costs. The guy who started this business a decade or so ago actually produced the kitchen units himself originally. Now he spends his time going around discussing with customers, drawing up what they need, discussing a price, and so on.
We are producing all kind of furniture, kitchens, bedrooms, office furniture. Well, I don't work any longer here in the workshop. I do a lot of the design work, speaking with people and contacts with the customers. When this work is done, it's usually about a week, we can begin to work to produce the furniture.
These are the transactions costs which always have to be met when you buy any good or service. What we're going to see is that the middleman is actually somebody who plays a valuable role for society in minimizing such transactions costs. Whenever people buy and sell, they engage in an exchange. In an advanced economy, they do it through the medium of money. But to illustrate the process of exchange, come to my island economy, where we only barter. That is, exchange goods without money. At the moment, there are only two of us on the island. I grow olives. Theodore grows apples. I want some of his apples. He wants some of my olives, so we exchange.
Okay, Theodore, best olives that I've grown. All right, they're a bit of sand on them, but
These are quality olives. Kilo of my olives for 5 of your apples.
No, I can give you only 3 apples.
3?
Yeah.
Well, it took me a long time to grow 4.
Yeah, but take a look at these apples.
Oh, gee, you're a hard man. Okay, I need the apples.
But there are some transactions costs associated with the exchange. We have to arrange to meet, agree a rate of exchange, and so on. But a third person has joined our community now. Mariella, who specializes in catching fish and wants to exchange her fish with our goods. How many exchanges on our island now? Theodore exchanges with Mariella. I exchange with Theodore. Mariella exchanges with me, so there are 3 exchanges, each one with the associated transactions costs. How many exchanges if a fourth person, Damien, joins us, who specializes in tomatoes? Suppose we grow to 100 of us, each specializing in some different product. How many exchanges then, assuming we each want some of the product of all the others? Working out the answer for large numbers is virtually impossible unless we do it by using a formula to work it out.
We'll let the number of people on our island be represented by a letter, N. We'll write it as a capital N because it could be a very large number. So given we don't know the number of people on the island, can we use N to establish a formula that will tell us the number of exchanges that will take place on the island?
Each of the N people, however many that is, will be exchanging with all the others. Everyone except himself or herself, that is, N minus 1 people. So we must multiply the N people with all the others, the N minus 1 people, to give N times n minus 1. But that would mean we count my exchange with Theodore as one exchange and his exchange with me as another. Now, in reality, it's only one exchange. And that will be true for all exchanges. There's only half the number implied by our term n times n minus 1. So now we divide n times n minus 1 by 2 to correct for that. Now that we have our formula, we can set n to any number we choose to see how many exchanges there are for any particular economy. So for my 4-person economy on our island, we have n equals 4, so n minus 1 will be 3, and we have 4 times 3 divided by 2 is equal to 6 exchanges. So with 5 people, 5 times 4, which we then divide by 2, gives us 10 exchanges. Suppose there is 100 of us. Then we have 100 times 99, which we then divide by 2, gives us 4,950 exchanges. Our formula helps us to see how quickly the number of exchanges and hence the amount of transactions cost rises as the numbers in our society increase. But now before we develop the idea, just let me remind you of the importance of putting the brackets around that term n minus 1. Without it, we'd have something completely different. Our formula without brackets would now be written as n times n minus 1 over 2. As you probably know, there's a mathematical convention that says when there's a series of operations to be performed, we stick with a particular order. What's in the brackets comes first, but we multiply before we subtract. So the top line would become n times n, or n squared, and then after that, we would subtract 1. So this gives us n squared minus 1 over 2. So in our society with 100 people, if we use this incorrect formula, we would get 100 times 100 equals 10,000, then minus 1 to give us 9,999. Then we would divide that by 2 to give us 4,999.5 exchanges. This is different from our formula with the brackets and wrong. And it's wrong because we left the brackets out of the formula here.
As our island economy grows, someone arrives and produces nothing. He simply sets up as a trader, exchanging other people's goods. Is he a useless parasite because he doesn't produce anything? He's actually very productive, and you understand that if you understand the nature of transactions costs.
We're now in a position to see just how productive for the community the middleman or the middlewoman can be. Let's assume we have a community of 100. If each of the members of our society can go and trade their produce for all other products, how many exchanges will there be? Each one of the 99 has to make just one trade with the trading post, so there are 99 exchanges. Let's generalize that with a second, even simpler formula. With a trading post, each of the N people trades with all the others except himself. So in an N-person economy, there'll be N minus 1 exchanges. The formula is simply N minus 1. So if there are 4 people, one of whom acts as a trading post, each of the other 3 will exchange with her. Since N is 4, 4 minus 1 equals 3. It's now easy to see that with 5 people, there are 4 exchanges. 5 minus 1 equals 4. And with 100 people, 99 exchanges. 100 minus 1 equals 99. And so on. So we can now compare the number of exchanges with and without a trading post for a 100-person economy. With no trading post, 4,950 exchanges. With a trading post, 99 exchanges. So the result of having a trading post is that we reduce the number of transactions costs from those associated with 4,950 to those associated with 99 exchanges, a saving of 4,851 lots of transactions costs. The middleman produces a highly valuable function in reducing transactions costs. This transaction cost saving is why, for example, many supermarkets are successful. In a modern society, people use money instead of barter, but the principle is the same. You get all the things you want and pay just once. You do it rather than go to a lot of different places because you save time and effort. In other words, it reduces transactions costs. As the size of the local population grows, so does the benefit of the supermarket in savings on transactions costs. So we started off thinking about whether we could use formulae to give us an insight into the way in which some aspects of the economy function. And we've seen, in this case, that you really can do that. By using a couple of not very frightening formulae, we were able to see what is the value of the middleman and how he's able to use his services to reduce transactions costs. So we've come to a conclusion. By using these formulae, that's perhaps counterintuitive. The next time you want to buy a kitchen, get the best value for money, and that might mean going direct to the manufacturer. But it might not.